I'm Lucy Leroni and welcome back to The Conservation Starter. I've already done quite a few videos about conservation in social media, how to consume and create content, and a few other different social media channels. But today I want to talk to you about Twitter, so let's jump right in. I found that people on Twitter are a bit more humorous and hilarious. They're a bit more witty and irreverent, and it's delightful. I love Twitter. I guess I see Twitter as a way of making infinite connections. It is a great way to create content, to share content from elsewhere, to engage with content that other people are creating. I also have to say, I get so much inspiration and information from Twitter. I get so many resources and there's so much innovation on there. So definitely recommend going and checking out all the different conservators, conservation departments, museums out there. You can have multiple accounts and they do make it quite easy for you to switch between Twitter accounts. So maybe that is something you can have, a personal and a professional one for conservation. To be honest, I just have one Twitter account just for conservation. And I think I resisted for a really long time to get it because I thought it was a bit too short and sharp and I didn't really see how conservation lent itself to being on Twitter. But now I'm on it. It's so good for conservation. You can customize Twitter as well in terms of a banner image, a profile image, and a little description. I strongly recommend utilizing all that and customizing it, letting people know who you are and giving them a bit of information. You can also include one link. This isn't as important as Instagram because you can include links down in your actual tweets, but I think it's still important. There's one link at the top prime place, so I definitely recommend utilizing that. Also, Twitter is often about in the moment. It's short, sharp content that can really quickly be superseded. Like, some people are so prolific and then I don't even know how many tweets a day or tweets an hour are shared. I should probably look that up. I'll look that up and pop it somewhere. There is so much content created on Twitter, like every second of every day. There's so much to consume out there, but it also can be very quickly superseded because it's mostly time-based, the way you see things. The way it appears, your content appears on your profile, is it's by time order. One way, if you've created a post in your far distant past that you really want people to see, you can pin a tweet right to the top. So that means it'll always stay up there, but you can only pin one tweet. So if you change your mind and want to pin something else, that's fine, but it means what you currently have pinned is going to disappear. It has some limitations set upon it, and I think because it has limitations, it leads people to being very creative. With the tweets that you do, you can only have 220 characters in them, so it means you need to be short and concise, and that includes links to other things, that includes your hashtags, it includes your tags to other accounts. You can create content that is just text, it can have hyperlinks, it can have a whole thread so you take people on a story with you. It can include media like photos, and the best format for photos to include in Twitter is a 16:9 ratio. It means that the whole photo is shown and there's no cropping. You can share up to 4 images onto a post. You can also share videos, but you don't have to share this kind of stuff. The main thing about Twitter is the tweet, the text itself. You can also share videos that are up to 220 seconds long. So I think the idea is it matches the limit of characters you're allowed to share. But I think there's endless possibilities on Twitter. I just love it so much. You can comment, like, retweet with quote. So one thing I do need to tell you about Twitter is once you've posted something, you cannot edit it, unlike a lot of other social media channels where it will let you edit the post. So that can be quite problematic. I have many a time whipped off a quick tweet on my phone, posted it, and then realized I had a spelling mistake, which is very embarrassing. I used to be an English tutor, so spelling mistakes I find particularly mortifying. You have the option of deleting the tweet, but that means you're losing all the engagement and interactions that people have already had with it. Or you can just leave it up there with the spelling mistake and just live with it. But that is something definitely to be aware of. And before you tweet, do a quick proofread. Other interesting ways that people are engaging with Twitter is seeing the options of using a traditional format like a conference and then turning it onto the Twitter sphere. So Icon did this really well with the Icon Twitter conference. So if you follow the hashtag IconTC, so Icon Twitter conference, you can go back and actually see the proceedings from the conference from previous years. So there was some really incredible, I don't know what you call it, papers that came out of this. So they do the presentations as a thread and they share lots of different media and people got really creative with what they shared on that. But basically, there is so much information out there, like so much good quality information. So I strongly recommend going and checking it out. Now, in terms of creating content, I've already mentioned some of the limitations of what you can and can't share. If you are sharing links to things, it is way more engaging to share a link that has a preview of what you're clicking on. If it's just a blue hyperlink, it kind of looks really boring and there's no reason that people will click on it unless you put a great tweet with it that describes what you're going to be clicking on. So instead, they have a lot of links have what you call cards, and that has like an image of what they're going to be going to along with the title and description. So if you go to Google and you type in Twitter card validator and click on the link, so you have to be logged into your Twitter account already, and then it asks for your card URL. So you click preview card and it'll show you what, if you share this link on Twitter, it'll look like. So it's really great so you know how your link's going to appear. Not all hyperlinks will actually have a card. I think it's to do with how people set up their websites. So it's a really great way to check. If you're trying to grow your social media, analytics are a really great way to do that. So on your individual posts, on the far right, there'll be three vertical lines, and that lets you click on your tweet analytics for that specific tweet. So there's lots of different data Twitter can give you, and some of it's more useful than others. Impressions just generally means that's how many people have had an opportunity to see it. So it's gone through on their feed and they've scrolled past it. What I think is actually a better and more important metric is the engagement. So that means people that have seen it and then have actually chosen to do something further with it. So they've clicked on something, they've expanded the details, they've liked it, they've commented on it, they've retweeted it or something like that. So you can do that on a specific tweet level, a granular level. I think the analytics only is for tweets that you've created, not for things you've retweeted. But I think you can still see analytics for tweets that you've retweeted with a quote. If you want to go on a more granular level, if you go to Google and go to Twitter analytics, again, you'll need to be logged into your Twitter. This is pretty much a whole website and a landing page just dedicated to analytics. I have to be honest, I don't really ever use this and ever go into it, but if you want to get really deep down into the analytics and work out what posts are working, what's not, who's engaging, who's not, what's your best performing tweet, you can use this to do that. So there is a whole website right there built literally for your Twitter account. So you can do all number of reports. I'm not an expert on this, so if you do want to know more, I strongly recommend looking up other tutorials on this. But it's a great way if you want to go more granular on what's doing well, what's not, and maybe gives you a bit of guidance on what content to create in the future. So one thing I want to show you is hashtags and how people use them. So you can't follow hashtags like you can on Instagram, but it is a way for you to search and find content. So recently there's been an incredible social media, I guess you call it, trend, which is Museum from Home. It was started in the UK and it's just a way for conservators that are having to work from home or museum professionals that are working from home to still engage with the general public and talk about their collections, even though they might not have their collections with them. I think it got picked up by the BBC and Museum from Home was trending, and then people have had their own interpretations on it. For example, I've done my own Museum from Home but honed in on conservation. Another one that I found recently is, I think it's Yorkshire Museum created the curator BAP tool. So it chooses a theme for the day and creates a hashtag for that, and then challenges museums and institutions around the world to beat their version of it. So the one that got picked up by General Media is the curator battle about the creepiest object, and there are some truly horrific things out there. It has there's been incredible engagement and reach. So there's been over 13,000 likes, and you can just imagine how many people have engaged with it and retweeted with it. So all these museums have posted their incredibly creepy objects, including the Maritime Museum. It's just fantastic. People can interact, react, retweet, up the ante. So every day I think they have a different theme, but by far their most famous curator battle object was the creepiest object. Oh my gosh, there's a best hat one. So I hope you've gotten some interesting information, some accounts or hashtags to look into, how to look at your analytics, how to create a Twitter card so you can see what your website link might be like, and some of the conventions of Twitter. It's a really fantastic platform. I don't think I can recommend it enough. I really love creating content on Twitter, but honestly, I think I prefer consuming it because there's just so much great stuff out there. So I think that's quite a lot about Twitter. I don't think I'm gonna say much else. Oh, GIFs. I just love that Twitter can use GIFs, and I've fully utilized that fact. Yeah, I just love GIFs.